for having me here. It's a pleasure, and the first time when I do something like that online, it's I hope it's going to go well, especially that I hope to include a live demo at the end. So let's see how it goes. I'm going to talk about automatic networks using Salt without running proxy minions. So both Salt, if you haven't heard of this tool, is an event-driven and data-driven configuration management and orchestration tool. And I have thrown here this paragraph from the documentation where they make a bit of advertisement to the product, of course. In the Salt stack, speed, they say, isn't a byproduct, it's the end goal, and so forth, as you can see here on the slide. The idea is just, it's a pretty nice tool to automate and deploy configuration changes on large scale of devices. But not only that, you can also have a bunch of other features like event-driven orchestration and so on, REST API and some other things that are probably beyond the topic of today. But if you are interested, they are pretty much covered. In general, when you look at Salt, typical architecture is a hub and spoke where we have a master which manages one more or you know thousands, tens of thousands of minion processes. These services run typically on a server infrastructure. So let's say master runs on a server and the minions on each of the servers you want to manage. It's not only hub and spoke, you can also have multiple masters, so your minions are managed by multiple this kind of masters in case one goes down, the others take over, and so on. This story doesn't apply exactly like this in the network world, because unfortunately, network devices are typically closed. You can't install any software product you want, like we would want to on a typical server. Let's say you want to manage a Cisco device or a Juniper. You just can say, I'm going to install the minion on the device and I'm going to manage it. You typically will have to run this minion service outside of the box itself. This is called a proxy minion. It's a process that can basically run anywhere, as long as it can connect to this master and to the network device you want to manage. Now, the connection between this proxy minion and the device is established via whatever your vendor allows you to do, via netconf, via HTTP, or you know, the terrible case when you have to manage it through plain SSH. In the Salt environment, the problem starts when you have, you know, thousands of devices like this, because each proxy minion manages one device. If you have thousands of devices, you will of course need to run and maintain thousands of this kind of proxy minion services, which is not particularly trivial. And also, you know, sometimes they, when you have thousands, you start looking into the memory consumption and it's not always beneficial. It sort of does. Sometimes it makes sense, but not always. For example, if you want to just to manage some console servers or something that you only touch once in a year or not even, it probably doesn't make sense to have a proxy minion service running there forever and consuming your resources. Talk about this, can jump over. Typically, the approach of managing Salt with these regular proxy minions. You have a master on a server or you have multiple masters, and then the proxy minions being deployed on one or more servers or in Docker containers or in Kubernetes clusters or anything, or you know, on a cloud, let's say, like I'm representing one of the cloud providers, so you can spin up as many virtual machines as you want, and you run your proxy minions over there. But again, that implies a cost which is not always justified. And this is why I created this tool called Salt S-Proxy or Salt SuperProxy, which is nothing else than a plugin that comes on top of Salt. which facilitates and allows you to manage your network through Salt in the exact way you are used to, but without having this burden to manage thousands of proxy minion services and being up and running all over and having them to be managed and so on and so forth, and with all these complications on the management side, but also on the monitoring and so on. Salt Proxy also allows you to have benefit from all this goodies from Salt, from the scalability, flexibility, but also other things like the REST API, but also what used to be called this event-driven automation and orchestration. All of these are still there. And we are talking about this architecture of having one master and I don't know how many proxy minion services that you have to maintain. Now it's all proxy, all of these go away. So you just have somewhere, doesn't matter where, on a server or on your local computer, anywhere from where you want to run this command, you have this Salt S proxy, which connects to these network devices you want to manage via the channels that you are allowed to use, and in exactly the same way as always. We're going to see in a bit what's the usual way to manage through Salt S proxy. The installation is very simple. Just is Salt S proxy is delivered is available on PyPy, which is the Python package index from where you usually download the Python packages. So you just install it as PIP install Salt S proxy. Then something a little bit different than the usual Salt is that in Salt, the minions connect to the master, and this is how the master knows who's managed by this master on a Salt S proxy, because there's no such thing, no concept of having a service running that connects to something. We need to tell and say, I want to manage this list of devices. Now, this list of devices is put in a Salt subsystem called roster. That's how they called it. Let's just take it as is. It's pretty much the equivalent in the Ansible world, if you want, of the inventory and so on. It's just a database of devices with some properties. And this Salt roster can be either a file as an SLS file. SLS meaning that can be YAML, can be JSON, can be a combination of YAML and Jinja, can be anything you want, even a pure Python script. If you have something more complicated, let's say, if you want to retrieve the list of devices from an HTTP API, you can have a small script in this file, and it's going to retrieve the devices for you. In this case, to keep it simple, I will have it as a YAML file, where I define this list of devices, let's say router one, which is going to be a Junos device, router two is IXXR, a spine, which is Junos, a leaf, which is an Arista, and the firewall, which is Palo Alto firewall. I'm going to go back and forth to this roster reference. It's probably not immediately obvious what these fields do, but I hope it's going to be clarified in time when it links together to other details. The second part of we need to have for the Salt S proxy to run correctly is referencing and telling what kind of roster it is. As I mentioned earlier, this roster can be many things, can be a file, can be a database, can be, doesn't matter, it's just a data source from where you pull the list of devices. In this case, as I said, is just a file. Together with this, there's another block under this proxy where you reference, when you give some details about how you connect to your network devices. In my example, I'm going to use Napalm, And this is why I have here a proxy type, but there are different other flavors of proxy modules that you can use to connect from Juniper, from Arista, if you want to be focused only on Arista and many others. Of course, you can also very easily put define a salt proxy module into your own environment and manage your devices using that. It's typically just 50 lines Python code, and it's quite easy to implement. Other details are the username and password for authentication, assuming you have the same username and password for all devices in your pool. If you don't, you have to put them into the roster, so it would be under this driver. You'd have to say, if you have a more specific a username for this router, you put it here, username, and the other username, and so on. Basically, in the roster, you put what is more specific for each device. Okay, I mentioned this, that you can get this list of devices from different sources. Again, it's not only Napalm, there are many other things you can use. And with these two files only, that's all, you can start executing commands. These commands are respect the usual salt syntax. So it begins with salt hyphen S proxy, then there's a target. A target can be many things. I'm going to share some examples. It's not particularly easy to get it from the beginning. So I will start with this example where I have a router star, which is a shell-like glob matching. So it's going to match router one and router two from our previous roster file. Again, same command. If you want to execute and pull the ARP tables, so execute this command, follow the function name. In this case, it's net.arp, or a different command. In this case, net.loadconfig, where you load some config on these devices, assuming they will ingest this config as Juniper, and it's going to execute this command on both routers. As a quick example how it looks like, because I didn't have enough space on this slide, if you run this command salt sproxy router one with net.load config and you load this configuration, is going to return back this output. We'll see also a bit later that this output only looks like this on the command line. It's behind the scenes, it's actually just a Python object. This is just a dictionary with all these keys here. It's just made to be displayed nicely on the command line, but behind you only work with data, don't work with blobs of text. As I mentioned, you can put this list of devices not only into a file, you can also have it pull them from an HTTP API, you have them into databases, into SQL databases or not SQL, into console, Redis, Mongo, and so on, or even if you want into a CSV file, hopefully not. Or here's another option using a NetBox roster. As it was previously, roster was referencing file roster module. In this case, is referencing the NetBox roster. It also requires some details where to find this NetBox server running, and eventually a token for authentication. And in the same way, salt as proxy is going to pull from this NetBox instance the list of devices you want to manage, and from there on, just execute the commands. This is another specific inherited from the main salt. Is using the REST API. You can execute the commands I mentioned from my previous examples via REST API, just by making some HTTP calls. In this case, you just put some configuration details into this master config file. It is old master. We say where to what port to listen, and also the path to the certificate and the key. And this is exactly what it needs, nothing more, just to, you know, install Sherry Python for the backend. And once you have this done, you just execute a HTTP call like this, where you provide details for authentication, if you probably want authentication, so make sure that nobody else that you don't want is going to execute commands on your network, and different functions like test.ping, say against router one, you're going to return this output. I'm not going to insist too much on this salt REST API. There's also a documentation, just wanted to mention it, that is there. It's pretty easy to use. You just put your devices into the roster, have them into the master. You have the configuration for the salt API, and there you go. Before I go jumping to the live demo, just wanted to have a short summary of why someone would use Salt as proxy. Firstly, because it's very easy to use and to install. You don't have to manage any, you know, services like to mess up with, I have to run also this master, I have to run, I don't know how many services. You just install it and use it, it's there. Just throw in some content into those configuration files, into the roster and master, and you are good to go. Also, if you have an existing Salt environment, if you already have a Salt master running and so on, if you install Salt as proxy in on the master where your master runs, it integrates just straight away. It's now you don't have to do anything else because it's automatically takes the master config from your existing master, and any command you execute through Salt as proxy is going to be executed also against your existing minions if your target matches those. REST API, as I mentioned, and also I hope I'm going to have time to exemplify how easy it is to integrate this Salt as proxy and execute commands from a Python console. Okay, the goal is not to execute from Python console, but I mean that this is a way you will see that how easy it is to create some, let's say, some scripts or some orchestration using Salt as proxy starting from here. In this case, I'm going to use another third party package called iSalt. Fortunately, I can't take any questions, so I will skip this and I will jump to the live demo. In this setup, I'm going to have a DigitalOcean droplet where I have Salt as proxy installed. I have a bunch of virtual machines running on Tesuto. I have only Juniper and Arista VMs, but they are in a pretty good number. So this is the topology. Actually, there's no topology, just some independent virtual machines for now, because you know it's pretty complex to also set up one entire topology. But I just wanted to see how it is to manage a pretty good number of devices just easily like this. So let's say we have two routers called router one and router two, and also 10 spine switches from spine one to spine 10, and 10 leafs from leaf one to leaf 10. In this case, so there are two routers, both are Junos VM. The leafs are all Arista VMs, and the spines are all Junos. Just choose like this for simplicity. Now, the files for this demo are here. I put them on GitHub and this repository. I'm going to show it right now. This is the repository. Here is the master file, and here is the roster file. Very quickly, I will go through it. The roster, the master file says references the roster, and in the roster, I define the devices. Now I will switch to my terminal because it's I have to I want to show you exactly the roster and what it means. So I have this router one, which says that is a Juniper device. It's available at this host, and I also have some grains, is called. These are some properties you specify statically for each device. In this case, I only have this grain called role, which says that this router one is a type router. And router two obviously also has a role router. Something more exciting here is this for loop. As I said, this roster can be just a plain YAML, but also can be a combination of Jinja plus YAML. So in this case, I have a for loop Jinja style, where I go from 1 to 10, because 11, it stops before 11, so at 10. So I'm going to generate dynamically this list of leaves and spine. So I'll generate leaf 1, spine 1, leaf 2, spine 2, and so on. In this case, I'm going to show you how it works. For example, if I want to I want to see what are the devices that I manage through this roster, I'm going to execute this salt sproxy star preview, and it's going to return the list of devices managed through this. So even though I didn't have to explicitly put each and every of these devices, they are there through that Jinja and YAML tricky thing. Okay, I am going to also present very quickly what I have in the master. There's one more thing. This is another essential. Oops, you saw my password. but anyway, I'm going to change, so hope nobody's going to make some jokes during our live session. So I have here the proxy type, the username, and the password. And what follows after is not essential for the beginning. Everything else that comes after is important when using the REST API. For example, this part for authentication, for to enable the Sherry Pie, it's exactly just like this. I'm disabled SSL and so on. And also some other optimizations. With this said, I'm going to go ahead, and I have here prepared a list of commands. Actually, I have it open here that I thought might be interesting to show you. I've shown you this one to preview the target. Here's another quick thing that's pretty important, actually, is this options hyphen capital V that displays you the list, basically the most important details from this environment, what Napalm version you have, the underlying salt version, and the version of the super proxy release. It's important sometimes to understand exactly what you have installed and if you have a version mismatch. I checked the targets, and now let's look a bit at the role grain I mentioned earlier. As I was saying, the grains are in this case the role grain was specified as a static property, so it's pretty obvious what it does in this case. In some other cases they can be quite interesting. And the grains in general means data collected from the device. Most of the time, this is data dynamically collected. So I'm just going to take one of these devices. So let's say spine 10. And if when executing this command, salt sproxy spine 10 grains.items, is going to connect to the device and retrieve and display the list of grains that salt sproxy is aware of for this device. And yeah, hopefully it's going to return at some point. Okay. going to go ahead with the other thing. I have here another command prepared to select. Okay, it looks like my first one, it took a while. I guess it's some communication issue. So when executing grains.items, it collected this list of properties, like DNS, like hardware interfaces, serial number, uptime, and so on. The idea is these grains, you don't really have to do anything about this. They are pretty much there unless you want to specify something statically. But when you want some detail, it's there. Some details are usually, these properties are usually quite useful in some contexts. And even today, I'm going to make use of this one, grains.os. This is how you access it. This is the OS grain that says that this is a Junos device. Okay. In my other terminal, in the meanwhile, I have executed this command that we can select devices based on this grain on the row. So let's say I want to select and execute a command against all the leaves. We'd have this syntax with hyphen capital G, and the role is leaf. Pretty straightforward. Next command I wanted to show quickly is executing a command like this, I want to execute against all the routers and to display me the routes to 0.0. It's going to come back with this output for each router. It says these are the routes and so on. One interesting thing I mentioned on the slides is that this output is only like this for a visual, to be nicely visual, but behind it's actually just some Python object which you can access, and if you have execute this function root.show, you can call it from a different module, from a different command, and in that command you just take this Python output nice like this, and we don't need to mess up with anything else. It's just there, and you can just access this information by simple dictionary keying. So we have this key router one, you extract this and we'll get this object. In a similar way, you can select and execute against all the spines. And I'm going to skip that and then jump to a different command where I execute against all devices. I execute this command net.loadTemplate, where I reference a template called, which is available at this path. SRV sol templates hostname.jinja. This template is also included in the GitHub repository I linked. So if you want, you can take a look at it. It's what it does. It's extremely simple. It's looking at the OS grain I mentioned earlier. It's one of the most important. So based on this, you can say if the device I'm running against right now is a Juniper, generate this config. If it's an Arista, generate this config. It configures just the host name using the ID of the minion I have specified. So would be router 1, router 2, leaf 1 to 10, and spine 1 to 10. So I'm going to run this command against all devices at the same time. Why was it important to have that specification and looking at the grain OS is because I'm using the same template against all devices. So it's not I'm not running separate commands for a device. So I have the business logic inside the template itself. It's arguably a good or bad practice depending on the use case. In some cases, when a template can get complex, you can split it up into multiple templates and then but they can abstract away this from the CLI. I'm going to change a little bit this syntax, and because SRV salt is a path that is well known for salt, you can execute the same command using this salt URI, salt column slash slash, and then the path, relative path from where the salt directory loads its files. So in this case is salt hyphen slash slash templates and hostname dot jinja. Each device comes up with a diff. It says that it's not already configured, and it says this is the diff for a Juniper. It would remove this hostname and would replace it with the other hostname. So these are the Juniper, and the Arista ones are in a similar way. The diff looks different because the syntax of Arista is different, of course, and this is the diff. I'm going to go a bit further and have a brief introduction to the state system. The state system is allows you to execute this kind of templates and the configuration changes without having to know exactly where you are, where your template is. So you say you have the template into SRV salt and the templates, as I mentioned, but you can reference this into a state. In this case, a hostname, what it does, let's not focus now on the syntax, but looking at this, you can probably just guess that I am running something against the same template as previously. And I give it a nice name change, hostname. Using this file name, hostname.sls, salt will know that when I execute a command like state.apply hostname, it's going to invoke that the content of this SLS file. So I'm going to run it again in a dry run mode. So it doesn't actually apply the changes. It only goes, applies changes, computes the diff, and returns back. And in this case, you can notice the output is slightly different. This is because it runs through the salt state system. And I didn't have to specify manually the path of the template because it's already referenced into the state. What I'm going to do now, I'm going to drop this testicle through, and I'm going to actually configure all these devices at once like this. Okay, you can see visually that the output looks a little bit different. It said that the configuration has been changed. Also, it says here at the end that it has succeeded, is the changes have been applied. For example, if I run again the same state, it should come back and say that there's nothing to do there. It's succeeded. It's already configured. Its host name is everywhere specified in the way you wanted me to. Something more interesting is when you want to execute some arbitrary RPC calls. So in this case, I'm going to show how you can get the list of LLP neighbors through an arbitrary RPC call. How you get this text get LLP neighbors information on Juniper, for example, you do your typical CLI commands, so like show LDP neighbors and then pipe display XML RPC, and you just get it from there. Through salt, you can invoke this RPC call through this command. Oop, that's quite long. This command, napalm.junosRPC. Why napalm? Because again, I'm running through a napalm. Through a napalm proxy minion, even though it's not actively running, but it still goes through those code sequences. So So it comes back with all this output exactly as you would get through the XML. So it's, again, this is structured data. I am now going to show you again that the output, raw output is as a Python object. You can also display this as a table. We don't have time right now, so I'm going to skip this, but it's a nice visual output to have it. Actually, I'm going to do this. Table. And so if you want to display it a bit more differently, the output, if you have something like a list, you can display it like that. Anyway, let's leave this, it's not important. In the exact same way as we did for Juniper to get, I'm going to increase this because maybe you don't really see it. When you're executing an arbitrary APC call, you can execute through Arista. I don't think I have enough time now. You can also define modules in your own environment, as in this case is example.version. I'm just going to execute it, but to invite you to go through the repository. And okay, my internet connection is pretty bad. And if you go here into the inog 14v module example, you will see the code here. This is what the salt execution module, custom execution module looks like. You just drop it into this special directory underscore module. It's really just the Python, Python code, nothing else, with some specifics. In this case, accessing grains and arbitrary salt functions. I'm not going to insist on this. I had a live demo on that too previously. And the idea is that using these kind of functions you notice on the CLI, you can execute them into your execution modules. And from there, you just take the output as normally. Okay. We have time. I think I'm a bit after, but I will pretend I don't know. So I'm going to start up the Salt API.
Yeah, we probably got about another minute or so.
Okay, I will be very quick. Sorry. Cool.
No, it's all good. It's all good.
Okay, so I started with this command, the Salt API, and I put it in background, in daemon mode. I will jump to my other terminal and I'll execute this command salt run store.event. What it does, you, with this command, you watch what happens on the salt bus all the time. So I'll go quickly and run a command router one, I don't know, something like net.arp again. And this is what it was seen on the salt bus. We've seen an event here that it says that we have a new job to be executed. This job is being executed against router one, and this is the output. It is a separate event for each step. So it's an event for when the command has been initiated, when it has been distributed to devices, and then one event for each return from each device. So that was the CLI side, and that was the event bus side where we have some structured data. Now, to confirm that the API is running correctly, you can execute just a simple HTTP call at this port where the Salt API is listening. And we should notice here this sproxy endpoint from where we can execute different commands. So I'm just copy paste, and with this, I should be done. Execute a request through the Salt API. This is what it looks like. In this case, there's no authentication, so don't do this in production through a test username. The client is sproxy because this is what we're going to use, so we don't need to run some proxy minimum services. And again, target and the function to run, and this is the return through the Salt API. To confirm, on the event bus side, it looks exactly the same as previously. Again, it says that a command has been executed, and this is the output from the devices that matched this command. And with this, I'm sorry if I kept you too much. Thanks for your attention. I didn't have time to go through as many things I was hoping to, but I hope it opened your appetite, and you know, hopefully you'll be interested into looking this. So if you have any questions, I'm on the iNOC Slack, or you can also ask me via email. Thanks.